I'm going to turn this morning to Acts chapter 9, verse 32 to 43. It's really a link passage to the one or two that follow, but we'll consider it together even now. Acts chapter 9, verses 32 to 43. And I want to address it under the heading, The Healing That Matters. The Healing That Matters. You know, we live in a world where we are absolutely dependent on doctors. Some of us have had a very personal experience of their great skill and power, even in the last few weeks. It's hard to imagine a world without them. But of course, the gospel wants us to understand that there'll be no doctors in heaven, for there'll be no need. There will be doctors who are in heaven because they've trusted the Lord Jesus, but they'll not be practicing medicine. They'll be indeed rejoicing with us in glory. This passage has two very important healings in it. And it would be possible to just concentrate on the healings and miss the result of both healings, which is the healing that matters. The fact that people were converted and brought into saving faith. I've got written here a little comment on doctors about a doctor who said to his patient, "I have bad news and worse news." So the patient said, "So let's have it. The bad news is that you only have 24 hours to live." "I can't imagine that could be anything worse than that." "Oh," said the doctor, "I forgot to tell you yesterday." We live in a world where sickness and pain is regular. And even in our little group, we've had our fair share of it in the last few weeks and months, have we not? But the Bible does have this great promise that pain and suffering are only for this world, and that there's a world coming in which there's no more tears, and that is the promise of the gospel that should be all our hope and confidence. I want to look at the passage with you and to establish that there are two kinds of healing. I want to look first at Aeneas and then secondly at Gazelle, which is called Tabitha and Dorcas in the passage, but her name means gazelle. To look secondly at gazelle, and then to finish up, God willing, with the all and many that are mentioned there in both accounts. Because while doctors are necessary here, and healing is something that we'll be wrestling with till the end of our days, and we finally lose the struggle with it, there is a healing which is permanent and eternal. And it's my desire this morning that you'll be reminded that you've received it if you're a Christian, and if not, you'll see the urgency of having it for yourself immediately. The passage starts out by telling us that Peter is continuing in the work he was commissioned to do, to go into all the world and preach the gospel, and he's doing it in an area to the northwest of Jerusalem. An area which includes the town of Lydda. And as he's there, he comes across a man called Aeneas. And there's not a great deal of detail about this man, but a wee bit of exploration told me that this name, Aeneas, would have been considered an important name in those days. For apparently, at the time of the battle over the city of Troy, remember the Greeks conquered it some hundreds of years before when they went in with the Trojan horse. One of the princes of Troy escaped, and his name was Aeneas. So to use the word Aeneas would have linked in their minds a picture of this great prince who had escaped to North Africa, and it doesn't finish there. The Romans believed that Aeneas was one of the originators of the civilization called Rome. So here's a man with a very important name. Here's a man who would lift up in people's minds all sorts of ideas and pictures of what a wonderful world they lived in. But in actual fact, we are shown here that he is actually just a man. Just a man constrained by the limitations of being human. There he found a certain man named Aeneas who had been bedridden 8 years and was paralyzed. What a picture of humanity. What a picture of the world around him. Again, he was probably a Gentile, and some of the commentators want us to think that here's a picture of the Gentiles in captivity and bondage, which Peter will later on go on to help. He brings me face to face with the reality that life is not a bed of roses. Well, of course, you knew that. Every one of us have had our troubles, may even still be having them. And who knows, they may be worse or better or whatever goes on. Life is a battle, a struggle with difficulties. Those of us who would remember George Wood might remember that when he was alive, he often quoted Job chapter 7 and verse 6. When you asked him how he was going, and it's stuck in my mind ever since that dear man parted to be with the Lord. Job 7:6, my days are swifter than a weaver's shuttle, and are spent without hope. My days are swifter than a weaver's shuttle. And it was significant for George because he was in his 90s. Looking back, he could say, there's nothing here to find hope or confidence in. His hope was in the Lord Jesus Christ. And again, you wouldn't be long in his company before you were reminded that he was resting completely upon what Jesus had accomplished at Calvary. But I thought of that verse in Job as being a good description of Aeneas and a good description of mankind in general, who are perhaps religious, might even have some importance about them, even if it's just his name. And they might seem to be special to the world around them, but in actual fact, they're on a slippery slope. And it's all downhill, isn't it? It's all downhill. Then he found a certain man named Aeneas who had been bedridden 8 years, bad enough, and was paralyzed. Here's a man who can't do anything for himself, can't be up about the business of the day, has to depend on people continually. But God has a solution for this man's illness and for the affliction that constrains every man and woman who are still without Christ. The preacher comes to him. And Peter, you'll remember, is an apostle. And as an apostle, he's been appointed by Christ to carry on the ministry of Christ. And part of that is to do miracles. And there is a certain parallel between what we have here and what happened in the life of the Lord Jesus. I'm told just a couple of weeks ago, the children in the back room were looking at that story of when Jesus was in the crowded house and the roof began to disintegrate above him as four men dug a hole in the roof and lowered the paralyzed man down. There seems to be a deliberate emphasis on Peter then, you see, carrying on the work that the Lord Jesus began. We'll see that in Gazelle in just a minute as well. It seems that when Luke was writing the gospel, of all the material he had to his hand, the things that he wanted were put into this gospel with the specific aim of getting us to that point where we realize that God's work continues. It continues down through the ages. What does Peter do when he gets into the room beside Aeneas? There's no great discussion. Peter said to him, there's an authority about it. He's standing there as a representative of Jesus Christ. Aeneas, Jesus the Christ healed you. I found it interesting. You don't often get Jesus the Christ. There's an emphasis, isn't there? Jesus is the one who was born to Mary, the one who fulfilled the promise that the Virgin would give birth and that God would come to be a saviour of sinners. The Christ is an emphasis on the one that was promised to Israel to fulfill David's shoes, to fill David's shoes, to fill Moses' shoes, and to bring about the kingdom of God. And so as Peter speaks, he speaks with authority. And that authority is not his own. I found this quite important as I saw it. We live in a day and age when people claim to be healers. And they want us to respect them because they have this healing power or ability. If you've not seen it, I'm not telling you it's on TV and you can watch it on some of those strange channels. Don't go there. But they claim to have this power just to put hands on people and they fall to the ground and somehow or another they are healed. In actual fact, Roy was telling us yesterday about Oral Roberts in his early days. Apparently when he was in a crusade in Australia, Roy's got all the details, I can only sketch in the things he told me, that he actually had a man under the stage where there was electric probes put into the stage. And when Oral Roberts declared the person healed, the switch was flicked or the current was put, and so the person felt a buzz. I need to check out some of the details, but Roy went on to say the Australians threw him out, quite rightly. But he's the grandfather of the modern health, wealth and prosperity movement. I can't think of the man's name, but one of the most prominent ones on TV was in fact his pilot. He saw what he could do and then just stepped into his shoes. It's a mischievous world where people claim that they have this power to heal. Peter makes no such claim. He makes it very clear that if there's going to be any healing done, it's Jesus who needs to do it. And so you have here Aeneas. Jesus the Christ heals you. Arise and make your bed. Cast your mind back to Mark chapter 2, verse 9, which is easier to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, arise, take up your bed and walk. But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, I say to you, arise, take up your bed and go to your house. Jesus is working through Peter. The gospel is being established. Peter is very clear, it's not his ability, it's Jesus' ability. In Acts chapter 3, when the man at the temple was healed and the people thought that Peter and John, wasn't it, were special, you get these words, Acts 3:12. Men of Israel, why do you marvel at this? And why do you look so intently at us as though by our own power or godliness we have made this man walk? And then verse 16. And his name, that's Jesus' name, through faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know. Yes, the faith which comes through him has given him the perfect soundness in the presence of you all. And so we find here Aeneas, completely healed by the grace of God. The end of verse 34 is straightforward. Then he arose immediately. 8 years on his bed. I don't even know if it was 8 seconds, but he's on his feet. Such is the power of Jesus. And that's the fulfillment of the promises of God in the scriptures. When Messiah came, he would establish a new kingdom, and that kingdom would be established by signs and wonders. Now, those signs and wonders were specifically linked to the apostles and their immediate generation. It's quite clear from the scripture that they soon ceased to act, and that the real sign and wonder is that through the preaching of the word, men and women are converted. When Paul is writing in 2 Corinthians 12, he says, truly the signs of an apostle were accomplished among you with all perseverance in signs and wonders and mighty deeds. You need to recognize that this healing is an indication that the kingdom of God has come and that Jesus Christ is now setting up that kingdom, and for its initial setting up there will be these miracles. You get the same parallel with Elijah and Elisha. There was a period of miracles. They were not the norm. You go back to Moses, you get this period of miracles, water from rocks. Pools cleared by throwing in a piece of wood. God establishes his work by these miracles. And another thing that occurred to me was that not everybody was healed. Peter had come to the area, he was preaching, there's no record of him emptying the hospitals. We were in the cafe yesterday morning and Roy was in John chapter 5, that's how the story came out about Oral Roberts. But again, when Jesus went to Bethesda, there was just one man sorted out. However many more were there in the other four porticos, they were not healed. You see, the healing is not for everybody in this world. The time when there's no illness and sickness is in the future. Here in this world, in the world, you will have tribulation. Be of good cheer, says Jesus, and overcome the world. The important thing here to see is that God is making it clear that his kingdom has arrived, and that through men like Aeneas, there is a picture of salvation. Now, as you look at Aeneas, I think we need to take a few minutes and drive it home that this is the picture of every unconverted man or woman. I'm old enough to remember when pneumonia, no, it was polio I wanted, when polio was still talked about as a curse. You remember how they used to treat polio? They would put children in an iron lung. Yes, they could breathe with the help of this machine, but what else could they do? That's Aeneas. That's a picture of a man or woman without Christ. Oh, they can think, they can talk, they may not be 100% paralyzed, they may do some things, but when it comes to the things of God, they're paralyzed. And what they need to hear is the command from Jesus Christ that they need to be spiritually healed, they need to be delivered from sin and judgment. And yet somehow it goes right over their heads. You remember, Christian, when God informed you of your great need? It would have been done in various forms. It fits us individually, but we become aware that for all our best efforts, we're not ever going to climb into heaven. And yet there are millions in that trap today. If I'm good enough, if I do my best, if I'm sincere, if I sacrifice and deny myself. And they're in this rut. And they don't seem to be able to see over the edges. What they need to hear is that Jesus, the Christ, makes men and women whole. And that's the message for every unbeliever. That's the message, Christian, that you have to take to the world. We're not simply to talk religion and talk about God. Our calling is to go into the world and say, I can't heal you, but Jesus can and will if you'll trust him. Do you think Aeneas did any real arguing that day? Excuse me, Peter, I'm quite happy here. This bed's comfy. And yet that's exactly what the unbeliever does, doesn't he? My life's okay. I've got this worked out. I've got that arranged. I'll be okay. You need to see yourself in this desperate condition. And then just when you're beginning to think, well, I'm not as bad as Aeneas, the story takes a further turn, a Joppa. If you know your Palestinian geography, you'll have seen Tel Aviv on the map. Joppa is presently a suburb of Tel Aviv. It was a whole city at those days. It was the major seaport where everything that came in and out of Israel came into the country. So over there in Joppa, there was a certain disciple named Tabitha, which is translated Dorcas. This woman was full of good works and charitable deeds which she did. What a lovely picture. I hope somebody's going to have something nice to say about me when I'm gone. But here you are, you see. This woman was loved, part of the church. But a dreadful reality has come into her life. But it happened in those days that she became sick and died. When they had washed her, they laid her in an upper room. As I said, her name is Gazelle. I wonder if she was given that because she was beautiful to look at. But it doesn't matter, does it? She could be the most beautiful person in this world of her day, but here comes the awful news, she's dead. Beauty has no advantage when oxygen stops moving in and out of your lungs, and 4 minutes later your brain stops functioning. It's a great thing if you are beautiful, I have no problem with that, but it has no advantage, does it? And it doesn't matter how good your life has been. And so he brings us to a very important concept, perception. We need to remember, you see, we're not permanent. We need to remember we're pilgrims on a journey. And we're all at different stages on that journey, and somewhere, somebody's going to say, oh yeah, him, her, she died. She died. And it won't matter then how popular you were or how busy you were in the church. I've no criticism of Dorcas or Tabitha, there's none here. She was obviously a very kind, sharing, caring lady. The kind of person you would want to be associated with. But in actual fact, she is not exempted from this horrible reality. And by putting this here, Luke wants us to come back and consider and remember, you see. We've all got an appointment to keep. And the only right way to keep it is to be ready for when it comes. One of the interesting distinctions in the passage is when it talks about Aeneas, he's only a certain man. But this lady is a disciple. That means she's a follower of the Lord Jesus. That means she's trusted him. She's been living under the benefit of what he did for her on Calvary. So I want to suggest to you, her sins are forgiven. And the death, while a tragedy on the human plane, is in fact promotion. She's gone home. She's in fellowship with the Savior who loved her. And dear friends, how we like to brush this subject under the carpet. If you talk like this in a conversation, you'll soon lose friends. If you talk like this, you could send yourself into a spiral of despair. But the reality is, you see, we can't go on here forever. We are time limited. There's a sell-by date on us. And we won't be left at the back of the fridge for something to find. I'm thinking yesterday, she's not listening, but Kat pulled out some ice cream. I like a little bit of ice cream. It was 2 years out of date. 2 years. Looked fine, but none of us were touching it. And the whole tub went down the sink. You see, we're all on a sell-by date, and this lady's sell-by date has come, and it's a tragedy, and I need to emphasize that. It would have been a bigger tragedy if it had been Aeneas that had died. Why? Because if he didn't have Christ as Savior, he would have been in eternal hell. And it almost seems like there's a gentleness here in helping us to see that Dorcas is a disciple and has the hope of glory. And it would appear that the church there in Joppa had a little inkling of what God was able to do through men like Peter. In Palestine, in Israel, because of the temperature, and in those days there wouldn't be any of the modern fancy morgues, when a person died, they buried them the next day. You see it on television in the Middle East, don't you? In all those catastrophes that have been going on, they wrap them up and they lay them to rest as quickly as possible. But they didn't do that with Gazelle, Dorcas, or Tabitha. What did they do? They washed the body, a loving care, and they put her in the upper room. And they didn't stop there, did they? And since Lydda was near Joppa, and the disciples had heard that Peter was there, they sent two men to him, imploring him not to delay in coming to them. And then Peter arose and went to them. Again, you have to think that the parallels are quite deliberate. You remember John chapter 11? Him whom you love is sick. Lazarus' sister sent for him, and the Savior delays, and by the time he gets there, he's gone. There's no doubt at all that what's happening here under the inspiration of the Spirit, that Luke is getting us to realize that while Jesus himself has died, risen and gone to glory, the work that Jesus began continues. And the hope that Jesus promised is right there for us today. I want to suggest to you that by putting her in the upper room and sending for people, these people had hope. They believed that God, in his mercy, would in fact and could in fact raise the dead. The Savior did it a number of times, didn't they? And they're disciples of the Savior, the one who's conquered death. You see something of the confusion and the pain, don't you, in the next verse? And since let me run down. Then Peter arose, verse 39, and went with them. And when he had come, they brought him to the upper room, and all the widows stood by him, weeping, showing the tunics and garments which Dorcas had made while she was with them. Oh, you can feel that pain. If you've got to my age in life, you've felt that pain. You've been in a room where people are just heartbroken because of a loved one. Just last August, my 43-year-old niece parted from this world very suddenly. That was one of the most painful funerals I've ever been at. There was no hope of Christ in her life, no time for him. It's a really painful occasion. There's nothing wrong with feeling the pain, with recognizing that when somebody goes, we miss them, we feel the loss, we lack the ability to communicate with them. That's the reason for grief, isn't it? And you've all felt that. But here's the good news, you see. Death is not the end. Just like Jesus, when he went to that tomb, Jesus will work through Peter to bring about healing. Then Peter arose and with them. Verse 40. But Peter put them all out and knelt down and prayed. There's a parallel here to the time when the Lord Jesus actually goes to heal the little girl. Everybody's in the house mourning. Mark chapter 5. Everybody's weeping and he puts them out of the room. It's no accident that it's happening here again in Acts chapter 9. Jesus is still present. Jesus is still working. Peter is not going to somehow transfer from himself some magical power and bring this girl back to life. He knelt down. He's humbling himself before God. He knelt down and he prayed. How would you have prayed if you'd been there? Lord Jesus, this is incredibly impossible. I don't have the power to raise the dead. These people are brokenhearted. I've got nothing to offer them in myself. But Lord, you raised the dead. You gave that command, Lazarus, come forth. And then he came. You're the same God. You have the same power. Your gospel ministry is established for the same purpose. Tabitha, arise. So simple. And God acts and God works. And this dear lady is once again on her feet and abounding in good works. This good lady is up on her feet and she's about the work of God once and more. And the people are thereby summoned to pay attention to Jesus. I want to summon you to pay attention to Jesus. To remember that Ephesians chapter 2, isn't it, begins by saying you were dead in trespasses and sins, but God has made you alive. I wonder how Tabitha felt when she was pulled back from eternity to have to serve a little longer on earth. But the fact is she is, and she would have a joy and a delight in serving God here. You know, these television so-called evangelists with their miracle-working powers and their ability to zap people, Some people have cynically said one of the great proofs that they're frauds is they don't go along and empty the local hospital. Because if they had such power, that's where they should be. National Health Service would no longer be in crisis, would it? And you might want to get on that bandwagon and press them down, but can I caution you for a minute? There's something more important than physical healing, and that's spiritual healing. I'd love to see the hospital closed, but I have a greater priority. I'd rather see the door to hell closed. And for that reason, I need to bring this before you. You know, there's nobody in hell that doesn't believe in God. Let it sink in. There are no unbelievers in hell. Because the minute they leave this world, they know for a certain they were wrong. And though they might have been an unbeliever in this world, in the next world, they're absolutely fully convinced, and it's breaking their heart. I'm not fully persuaded that the torment of hell is just simply fire, as some people describe it. I believe the real torment of hell will be inside. And especially for folks that sat in gospel churches who will be able to remember, I was that close. And yet for some imaginary question, I didn't take the benefit. Jesus heals. And he heals sinners. That's what you see here. And that's what I've passed over. I've had to bite my tongue twice. Notice verse 35. So all who dwelt in Lydda and Sharon saw him and turned to the Lord. And look at it again in verse 42. And it became known throughout all Joppa, and many believed on the Lord. What do you call that? That's revival, isn't it? That's God moving. And that's where the miracle of these two folks comes into focus. You might read this chapter and go away wondering about Aeneas, wondering about Tabitha, and thinking what it must have been like, but you miss the point. They are declarations by God that his Son, the Savior, is alive, and that his gospel and message is able to do far more than anybody can even begin to or imagine. It can take people who are physically well but spiritually dead and give them eternal life. That's the pattern of the Acts of the Apostles. Acts chapter 2, remember that glorious sermon Peter preached about Jesus being the one that David spoke of, being the one that had fulfilled all that David looked to, the one who had caused the outpouring of the Spirit. Acts 2, 37. Now when they heard this, that's the Jews, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said to them, and I believe Peter would have been saying it to these people in Lydda, Sharon and Joppa. And Peter said to them, repent, and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. I want to show you that that's precisely what must have been going on. If you look back at verse 35 and study the words, so all who dwelt at Lydda and Sharon saw him, and here's the word, and turned to the Lord. The word for turn to is in fact one of the Greek words for repent. So in the same way that he had told those earlier Christians or earlier people to repent, he must have been telling the people in those areas, don't just get focused on Aeneas and what's happened to him. This has implications for you. You're going in the wrong direction. You need to turn around. You know, there are three words translated repent, and they're all very interesting. One means to have a change in the way you think. The other one means to go in a different direction. And that's the one that's here. You would only change your direction when your thinking had been changed. And we're told that in the scriptures, that's a glorious work of God. Remember chapter 5, verse 31? Talking about the Lord Jesus, it says, Him God has exalted to the right hand to be Prince and Saviour, to give repentance to Israel and the forgiveness of sins. And so Jesus, who gave this man life, has been giving these people spiritual life. Oh, how repentance is forgotten, isn't it? And yet it was John the Baptist's ministry, wasn't it? Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. And do you know what Jesus' first sermon is? First time he opens his mouth and begins to preach according to the scripture. Repent. And it brings me face to face, you see, with the fact that this world is going in the wrong direction. And you're going in the wrong direction if you're just going along with the world. There's a broad way that leads to destruction. And everybody's on it by nature. It's a long time since, but I remember when lemmings were suddenly discovered. They've probably been around for thousands of years, but they were all brought to our notice. These crazy creatures which run to the edge of a cliff, they all jump off, don't they? And kill themselves. That's mankind. That's man who says, get out of my way, God, I'll manage this myself. And God graciously sent his Son to tell us the truth, to die for our sins, and then to open the door that you might go in. And the incredible wickedness of humanity is seen in this. They say, yeah, I'll go my own way. The theme song, isn't there? So many funerals. Frank Sinatra. I did it my way. Breaks my heart whenever I hear it. I'm doing it my way. Oh, dearly beloved, you're heading for a collision which is tragic and unavoidable. It's like standing in the middle of a rail track with an express train coming. What do you need to do? Get off the rails. Stop being so proud and independent and arrogant and move over. Trust Jesus Christ as your Saviour and your Lord. There's a second word which I want to get to before we're finished. Somebody's going to move it over the page. And it became known throughout all Joppa, verse 42, and many believed. You see, repentance and faith are like two sides of the same coin. They go together, hand in hand. And when you get one, you can generally assume that the other's present as well. But there was an emphasis in Aeneas' neighbours that they specifically repented. They recognised they were in the wrong direction. Whereas with Dorcas, the emphasis is that these people now came to believe. They've turned. But they've not turned just to take another route. They've turned to Jesus. They've turned to believe in him. She's bounced back to life. The news spreads. People are scratching their head and they're saying there must be something to this Jesus. I need him as my Saviour and my Lord. I want to cast myself upon him for mercy. And I need to get to the end of the sermon and just emphasise, dear friend, I remember when that happened to me. Dunfermline, 1970. In my own living room. I should have written the date down, but I think it was the 18th of May. And in that place I was confronted that I had information that I had to act upon. I had to do something about it. And what did I need to do? I need to accept it as true or cast it away as lies. Thank God for the ability to accept it as true. Thank God for the power of God, which delivers us from the delusion that life's only about life. This, dear friend, is the entrance portal to eternity. And one day You have to go through the door. And they're not waiting for you to make up your mind. There's only one safe way to go through that door, and that is believing that Jesus Christ is the Saviour of sinners. And that believing is a believing which means then you will be trusting Him as your Saviour to save this sinner. That believing is just so simple, isn't it? Like the thief on the cross, as I was saying to the children, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom," says the man to him. Jesus says, "Today." Today! Wouldn't that be great if this was your today? Wouldn't it be fabulous if you went home and you could write on your calendar, "This is the day I cast myself upon Christ and He saved me"? Wouldn't it be great? I hope you do keep a record as far as you can, because for some folks it's a gentle process. And we need to be careful not to put everybody in a guilt trip because they can't name the date and time. The evidence is who is your confidence? Are you trusting yourself or are you trusting Christ? Remember we started out talking about doctors? I read about a lady who had gone to the doctor in the days when the doctor dispensed the medicine himself. She only went with a cold apparently. So the doctor got some medicine out and told her to take it. A few days later, he was called to her house. And the cold had settled in her chest. Oh, what did he do? He got some more medicine out and gave it to her to take it. But the woman died. She should have survived. The medicine was there. It was in a conversation with her sister some days later that he found out that as soon as he left the house, she poured the medicine down the sink. She had the solution and had no benefit. Isn't that what an unbeliever does every time they hear the gospel and they go home unconverted? Oh, that today would be your day when you would take the medicine from the great healer, Jesus Christ, and be saved. Amen.